You might think that the quotient rule is a straightforward consequence of the product rule. Well, it is a consequence of the product rule, but there is a complication. We need to make sure that we are not dividing by zero. Once we have avoided that problem, proving the quotient rule is just one line. But its first complication causes quite some problems, which we will solve in this video. So, the quotient rule. What are we going to prove first? Well, we are going to do this first. If limit x to a g of x equals L2 non-zero, then limit x to a of 1 over g of x equals 1 over L2. And once we have done this, quotient rule will be easy, but this it will be the hard part. So what is given? We can make g minus L2 small, so given any epsilon 1 bigger than 0, we have a delta 1 such that if x minus a norm is smaller than delta 1, then our g minus L2 will be smaller than epsilon 1. That's what is given. What do we need to prove? Well, something about 1 minus g minus 1 minus 1 over g minus 1 over L2. We'll have to be able to make that small, smaller than n, epsilon bigger than 0, provided we take x minus a smaller than delta. And the problem is that we need to make sure that we don't get zeros over there, because we cannot divide by zero. So how are we going to do that? Well, we are going to use that L2 is not equal to zero. So that means that we know that that the norm of L2 is bigger than zero. That's what we need. We need to show that 1 over g minus 1 over L2 becomes small. So, first of all, we make from that one fraction. So, that's what we've done over here. So, we have L2 minus g, and that is nice, because that will become small. We can get that small, but we also have to divide by g times L2, and we have to make sure that that will not become zero, because then our difference will still blow up. So, we know that the norm of 1 over g minus 1 over L2 equals norm of L2 minus g, okay, divided by norm of g, norm of L2. So, then we know that our L2 is not zero, so the norm of L2 is positive. So we know norm of L2 is bigger than zero, so the norm of L2 is bigger or equal than some number epsilon, epsilon 2. So, suppose, for example, our L2 is 5, and we could take our epsilon 2 as 2, something like that. We know that there's a positive number below the L2 such that the L2 is bigger or equal than this epsilon 2. And why do we need that? Well, then we know that we can pick a delta 1 such that g minus L2 is smaller than 1 half of this epsilon 2. I can get my g close to L2. Why do we need to do that? We want to make sure that this 1 over g norm stays away from 0. So, what happens if we pick g minus L2 in norm smaller than 1 half of this epsilon 2, provided we take again x, norm of x minus a smaller than some delta 1? Well, then we know that the L2 is bigger or equal than epsilon 2 in norm. And this g minus L2 is in an interval plus or minus 1 half epsilon 2 around that. That means that our g itself is still away from 0 by at least a factor epsilon over 2. So we know that our g, norm of our g is bigger or equal than 1 half epsilon 2 over 2. Because here L2, epsilon 2, and then small interval with size 1 half epsilon 2 around it. So still norm of g is, we can get it away from this nasty 0 in order to avoid dividing by 0. So what do we do then? Norm of g times norm of L2 is bigger equal than 1 half epsilon 2 from the norm of g times an epsilon 2 of the norm of L. So if we take the 1 over g minus L2, that is then, if g L2 is bigger than something, then 1 over g L2 is smaller equal to something. So that is smaller than 2 over epsilon 2 squared times L2 minus G if we take x close enough to A. Well, and then we have avoided the problem close to zero, and then we are then we can proceed smoothly, because given our epsilon bigger than zero and given our L2, our limit, we can find, given L2, we can find our epsilon 2. And given our epsilon 2 and epsilon, we can set an epsilon 1 as follows, as epsilon 2 squared times epsilon over 2. And then I know with this epsilon 1, I can again find a delta 2 such that my norm of G minus L2 is smaller than this particular epsilon 1, given norm of x minus a is smaller than delta 2. And why did we take this epsilon 1 in such a strange way? Well, we pick delta to be the minimum of delta 1 and delta 2. Then I know that both this inequality here holds and the other inequality over here holds. So I know that my norm of 1 over g minus 1 over l smaller equal than this one from the first inequality, smaller than this one from the second inequality. That's why you have to pick the minimum of the both deltas. And you'll see that all those factors 2 and epsilon 2 naturally cancel out. So that is smaller than epsilon, provided you pick the norm of x minus a smaller than this delta. And now we've done the hard work. So now I know if g goes to l, then 1 over g goes to 1 over l, provided l is not equal to 0. And then we can prove our quotient rule, just combining this with the product rule. So what does the quotient rule say? Well, if a limit x to a of f equals l1 and x to a g equals l2 not equal to 0, then limit x to a of f over g equals l1 over l2. So how can we prove this? Well, f over g equals f times 1 over g. And then we use the product rule, so separate that in two limits. X to a of f times x to a of 1 over g. Well, the first limit equals L1, and we have done the hard work for the second limit. The second limit equals 1 over L2, so that yields L1 over L2, and there we have our quotient rule. So, as you see, quotient rule is indeed a straightforward consequence of the product rule, but you really need to be careful to stay away from zero with your denominator, and that is what took quite some effort in proving the quotient rule.